very good afternoon to one and all. Continuing its pursuit of excellence, today the Vinod Gupta School of Management, IIT Kharagpur, is honored to host Mr. Benoit Roubaix, Senior Vice President and Head of International Retail at Dalmia Bharat Group, for the next edition of its online leadership talk series, Vakya. An innovative, entrepreneurial, and dynamic senior operations leader, Mr. Roubaix is passionate about driving businesses, people, and processes to effectively support ambitious operational, revenue, and growth objectives. Equipped with over 20 years of proven success in generating revenue, accelerating employee performance, building brand visibility, and maximizing shareholder value in the highly competitive retail industry, he has a wide repertoire of international experience in France, Romania, and Brazil, apart from India. With a confident and well-developed communication style that establishes credibility and facilitates clear understanding of issues, Mr. Roubaix is skilled in identifying and capturing market opportunities and equally effective in streamlining and strengthening existing operations. We enthusiastically look forward to an exciting session, and without any further delay, I would invite our esteemed guest to address the inquisitive minds. Over to you, sir.
Presentation. So, just for you to understand, you know, and to share, for us, the blockchain in the retail industry is very, useful also, I would say, for many reasons. First, as you have seen in the video, in terms of speed, for example, in the cash transaction or monetary transaction, that will help us a lot. And, you know, for example, I can't share too much data because it's a startup, and I have to remain with my part of confidentiality. But just in a general way, I would say, in the retail business, the blockchain is very interesting to secure the transaction. That's the first important aspect for the cash transaction, but not only, also for, you know, the online, you know, transaction. For example, when we build a retail business, now it's not only brick and mortar. You have an online site, and you have to share a lot of contents, photography, technical details about the product, etc. So you, with the digital, with the blockchain technology, you win a lot of time. The customer will win a lot of time also in terms of click on the site. So that's really powerful, and that's something I would say we need to implement now. That's something mandatory, I would say. So I hope that was clear. That was for the blockchain technology. Of course, you can go more in detail, but I like this video because it's quite simple to understand. I would like to share two more videos. I hope I will have a little bit more chance. So I don't know. Maybe I will have to do the same. Attends, just one. So if I start the video, just let me know if. It's a video about robots. I have two videos. One is short, 3 minutes, and one is 9 minutes. So let me show you the first one. Just tell me if you see the video. If not, I will try. Do you see my screen now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. The Chrome window is visible.
Okay, super, super, super. So let's start the video. You see my video here, yeah?
Yes, sir.
It is super. So let's see that video.
Flyability introduces Elios, the world's first collision-tolerant drone. Access confined and complex spaces without any risk of crashing. Elios features a full HD camera and a thermal camera embedded on the drone. The robot's live video feed allows the operator to get the drone to the most inaccessible places, up to 5 kilometers when in direct line of sight. Gather close-up images for high-resolution data with a sub-millimeter resolution. Onboard LED lighting system and a complete remote control of the camera settings allows to navigate and inspect even in pitch-dark environments.
Sorry, this is my...
Changing the batteries only takes seconds. Just unplug the used one, insert another of the provided batteries, and you are back to flying again. Elios is safe to fly close and even in contact with humans. It avoids expensive, hazardous, and time-consuming access methods such as scaffolding, rope access, or skyclimbers. It is incredibly easy to operate, and after only a few hours of training, you will be able to perform your first jobs. The payload head tilts over 180 degrees. Elios avoids human entry in confined spaces for visual inspection, highly reducing the risk for workers. It can be operated beyond line of sight, using the robust video feedback to navigate. Instead of focusing on avoiding obstacles, you can use obstacles to find your way and roll on the surfaces in addition to flying. Stored on an SD card onboard Elios, the data from the flight can be immediately reviewed and analyzed by your team and exported to include in your reports. At FlyAbilities offices in Switzerland, our team has been developing this patented device for the last 5 years, designing 7 prototype iterations, improved through extensive work on the field with industrial customers. Elios increases workers' safety, reduces inspection costs, and helps reduce downtime. In the energy production industry, for the inspection of boilers, heat recovery steam generators, and other large structures. In the oil and gas and maritime industries, for the inspection of above-ground tanks, pressure vessels, as well as ship holds, ballasts, and voids. And in many other industries for the inspection and exploration of indoors, inaccessible, confined, or complex spaces. Inspect and explore places that could previously not be reached. Push UAV boundaries.
So this was the first video about, you know, robotics. I will just I will close here, maybe on here. I hope I am back the presentation. Cisco. Presentation. That's here. You can. Yeah. Okay. Share. So. Sorry. So I am audible now. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. I will continue. Just. No. I will share my PowerPoint. So that was the first one. So just here to share the insight. What is it? It is interesting for the retail industry. This kind of you know, robotics in the retail industry was very useful also in terms of cost optimization. For example, you know, when you have a warehouse on physical stores, or you need to you know, consult the roof, you need to accelerate, you know, the inspection, or sometimes it's very complicated to access also. This kind of technology is really useful, even in our industry. On here, it was an example with technology, you know, for the, I would say, safety control, etc. But the second one is even more interesting. I would like to share that video with you, hoping that it will work. So just tell me, or this is the last video. It's a little bit longer. It's a video of 9 minutes. Just tell me if you see the video, but you will see a very different video. It's about, you know, technology, but I would say with a philosophical approach, I would say. Just I want to share it with you, and after that, we will have some maybe some discussion at the end about that video. Just let me know if it's visible for you. Just one moment. So do you see my screen now?
Yes, sir, it's visible.
Okay, super. So I will start.
Some economists say the world is entering a second machine age. Artificial intelligence and other advancements
enabling robots to do tasks that until now only human eyes, minds, and hands could handle. For this episode of Moving Upstream, we traveled through Asia to meet the next generation of industrial robots, where robots are making robots.
Well, they're making love, these robots. They're making babies.
Yes, right.
To see how they're changing manufacturing and whether they're stealing the fate of low-skilled workers. Every other year, Tokyo plays host to the world's largest robotics trade show, IREX. It's no coincidence the show is in Asia. Here, robots are being bought and sold in numbers unrivaled anywhere else in the world. These are the types of robots Professor Erik Brynjolfsson is keeping an eye on as MIT's chief scholar on the digital economy.
We used to have to really painstakingly teach the machines step by step, program them what to do. And now machine learning is enabling the machines to figure out on their own how to solve problems. You put together the algorithms, the data, and the computer chips, and you get sometimes a million-fold improvement in the performance of these systems.
A million-fold improvement?
Yeah.
And what does that allow you to do?
So one really important thing to do on the factory floor is just be able to recognize objects. And that's something that only humans could do well until recently.
At IREX, we witnessed a robot handling a task that I, as a human, don't do so well. Futzing with one of those pesky tape dispensers. It's among the latest offerings from Yaskawa, one of the world's largest manufacturers of industrial robots. Its main sellers are large industrial robots that do dangerous things like welding car parts. We visit one of Yaskawa's robot manufacturing facilities in the southern port city of Kitakyushu. Here, the public can try controlling and racing against AI-enhanced robot arms.
You're done.
We got to see where the robots are made.
The robots themselves, they're sealed off by these plastic barriers. The workers aren't allowed to be in there while they're in operation because they're making these very fast movements.
The head of the robotics division at Yaskawa, Masahiro Ogawa, seems most excited to talk about robots that don't need to be walled off from humans, that work alongside employees, an industry we call cobots. The International Federation of Robots predicts in coming years, cobots will lead the robotics industry. That's partially with driving startups like China-based Elephant Robotics to get in the game. Ask their founder, Juni Song, how his cobot is different from traditional robot arms.
It's not that quick, and it is very, very light. Okay. So it can work with people. So this is the most important thing.
In addition to being safer, the collaboration proves to be more productive. A study conducted by MIT researchers found that human-machine groups were more efficient than teams wholly comprised of one or the other. They also reduced human idle time by 85%. While traveling through Japan, we visited Huishitenbosch, a Holland-themed amusement park. There we checked out its latest attraction, a robot restaurant.
How many Okonomiyaki pancakes can the robot make in an hour?
My colleague Matt McDonald, after getting a robot mixed cocktail,
Kanpai.
Tried the robot chef's signature dish. It's gimmick by design. Back at Yaskawa, Ogawa tells us most of the customers who come to him looking for new automation solutions come from China.
China market huge, and the growth ratio very high.
How high? Last year, Chinese demand for robots grew more than 20%. One reason for that is China's working population is aging, By 2060, the average Chinese citizen is projected to be 50 years old. To see the impact of industrial robots on manufacturing in China, we traveled to an area that's considered the electronics capital of the world, the Pearl River Delta region. Headquartered there is Rapu, China's largest keyboard and mice manufacturer. We asked the CEO why his company is making the move towards robotics.
Because in China have a rapid salary increase beginning from 2008. So we feel the little pressure from the labor side. So we decided to change a lot our manufacturing system to robot.
Wages for the average urban employee in China have more than doubled since 2008. Rapu, he says, in the past few years, used robotics to reduce its factory workforce from 2,500 people to now 1,000. More automation is on the way.
So you're bringing more robots in?
Yeah, and then make the, even the logistics will use a robot.
You seem very happy about this.
Yeah. Because it will make my company more competitive. Yeah.
And you're not worried when you lay off those 700 workers?
No, they can easily get jobs. No problem.
China's unemployment rate is 4.6%, pretty low. And the Chinese government says it's even lower in urban areas.
Most of them are getting jobs. They're not having to go back to the farm.
They cannot go back. They can go back, but for them, it's no meaning to go back because they will easily find another job because China is growing very fast.
When we talk to CEOs in China, you think they're being forthright? Do you think they're being accurate?
Broadly, I think they are. I think that there are going to be lots and lots of jobs that are automated, millions, hundreds of millions of jobs that won't be needed because robots will do them. But there's no shortage of work that only humans can do.
Indeed, in China, the category of jobs that are growing fastest are in the service sector.
Is there any resistance from workers to putting these new robots in?
No, because they have no choice.
Your plant that you oversee has already been automated 80%, you said. Do you see it going the rest of that 20%?
Li Zhendu, a worker at the Rapu factory, has watched as robots have replaced his colleagues.
Yokono, how far off do you think we are from full automation? Nobody left working in your department.
Chinese delivery company JD is showing how automation is advancing in other industries like logistics. There are still some employees here, but not at a JD sorting center near Shanghai. It's taking nearly all humans out of this process. And this is the same company that last year began making drone deliveries.
This is a moment of choice and opportunity. It could be the best 10 years ahead of us that we've ever had in human history, or one of the worst, because we have more power than we've ever had before. Tools by themselves are not going to lift up the billions of people who are being left behind. Those are conscious choices we have to make as a society and as individuals.
In just 6 years, worldwide sales of industrial robots have risen more than 140%. What do you think about robots taking on more work? We look forward to reading your comments. Thanks for watching.
So that was the video about robots. Let's just me come back to the presentation. Just let me do that. Just one moment. This is not here. This is cool. So do you see my screen now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so you know this video was
yes sir.
I hope you enjoyed the video I find that this video very interesting because, you know, we speak even in the retail industry about optimization process. Amazon is a very good example, of course, on this. Amazon is based on this optimization of supply chain. And that's the kind of, challenge, I would say, on opportunities also that we have to take into consideration in the retail business that we are building today for tomorrow, because Amazon will still be there. And I have seen that, Jeff Bezos is investing lots of money in India also. So that we have to take this into consideration. After that, you have a lot, I'm sure, all of you, lots of philosophical questions. You have seen that CEO that says that, people, they get jobs. Yeah, probably he's right, because, you know, that was in the video also. The machines will not, erase, the jobs. They will just create some new opportunities. That's, I would say, at least a positive mindset. But of course, you can have a lot of questions on debates about that. That's not something, it's not black or white, I would say. So I would just let you with that kind of question here on to think about who creates value for whom in that video. That's something we had made in the VU Academy. We have a lot of debates about that. What's implication for firms, resource management of innovation? Does the company have resources to invest, in that technologic, needs, I would say? What are the implications of digital manufacturing on customer-centering digital innovation? That's a lot of, implication. I want to share also with you, for example, in the warehouse, the way we are, making on setting up the installation on the assets of, our business is really important at the very beginning. Because if you don't make the good choice at the very beginning, you will never have the opportunity to, I would say, recover, this issue. That's something I wanted to share also with you. That's for that, it's very important. I was sharing with you this, design thinking approach, which is to try to think very globally and to imagine all the different possibility on issues also that you can face in the future with the competitors, with that's something on the technology in the retail industry is being more and more important, I would say, and critical to make a business successful. So that's something I wanted to share with you. I hope you really enjoyed that that video, because there is a lot of message in that video. It's not only technology, it's about retail, about the future, how can we anticipate, how can we anticipate the relationship between humans and machines. You see at the time in the video that the machine only alone are less productive than the machine plus the human. The human alone are less productive than the machines. And the best deal, I would say, is a machine plus human, these cobots, like the person share with us in the video solution, which is something interesting for the retail business also in the future. And it's true also in the warehouse, but also in the store. I would still think that's a personal view, of course, that in the store, because you have seen also this restaurant with this robot who is serving a customer. I will still believe that we have a very important role to play in the way we welcome our customers. And I think that will be true also in the coming years, because even more in the home building retail business, because most of the time when you interact with the customers in our industry, it's different from the FMCG retail industry. FMCG retail industry, the food industry, you don't need necessarily the team to deliver the product. If you need a Coca-Cola, a bottle of Coca-Cola, okay, you will go to the store and you will find the bottle of Coca-Cola. You don't need necessarily the team to help you, maybe to find the product, but that's it. In the home building business, that's very different, because when you need, for example, you are contractors, even in a B2B business model, the contractor maybe will need some technical information about the product, some specificity about how do you install, for example, a kitchen or a sanitary ware. So you have also to make the good choice. You have to take in a very accurate way what is the need of your retail industry and what is the interaction you want to install with the customers. That is not only a matter of technology. I would say it's a matter of culture, on how do you want to build your culture in the coming years. Because of course, you see, you can feel that, in a restaurant with robots, I would say that the ambiance is, from my perspective, quite different, I would say, from, a restaurant with people physically who are smiling, who are interacting with you, maybe joking sometimes, etc., taking care of some small details. So I will believe that as human, we still have a very important role to play. That's my thinking. I wanted to share with you. I am still audible on my screen is visible, no? Do you see the books now?
Yes, sir. It's visible.
I wanted to share with you in that COVID period, before going to the question, some books I like a lot. Donc here the same. I don't have any action. I don't get any money from Simon Sinek, but I like a lot in that COVID-19 period. It's important maybe for you to have some opportunity or. At least I want to share the books I like a lot. Donc start with why, which is the kind of interaction we had today. We discuss, we learn from each other. I learn from you, of course, also. And that's very interesting. I read that book, and that's wonderful. I really invite you to read that book. The second one is still from Simon Sinek, and it is, The Infinite Game, which is the same, really interesting. I will encore. It's about management, leadership, and what is the mindset that a leader should have or may have, in the coming years, and with the particular time that we had now. And the last one is. Emotional intelligence, and I will really recommend you. Donc, this is a different author. This is Daniel Goleman, which is very known also. Maybe some of you have read that book. If that's the case, that's not an issue. But if not, I will encourage you to read. Very interesting book also. Book also about emotional intelligence, and even if we speak about technology, digitalization, etc., still as human, the way we communicate between us, the way we interact with our teams, the way we motivate our teams, doesn't mean you are not exigent, but the way you motivate your team is crucial and make a huge difference, I would say. And this book is about that, emotional intelligence. I would like also to share with you some nice quotation I like a lot. The first one is from Peter Drucker. Organizations rarely decline because the world changes. organizations decline because they don't change. And I think it's something very true. And it's also for myself and for all of us, I think. We have to adapt and to, you know, to remain, open, I would say. The next one is about leadership also. Over the next decade, AI, artificial intelligence, won't replace managers. But managers who use artificial intelligence will replace those who don't. And I think it's true also. We don't have to be afraid about artificial intelligence. We just have to adapt and to make the best use possible of the artificial intelligence. That's a very different meaning. This one is nice also, and make a good transition between human and technology. The future belongs to those individuals, leaders, business units, societies, countries that optimize the man-machine duality. Exactly what we have seen, in the video. The best performance is when both human and machine are making the job together. I hope I am really sorry for this little interruption in my presentation with the video. I hope you have seen the video quite in a comfort way and visible. And I am really open to answer your question and to share some information if I can with you. So if you have any question, please go ahead.
So there are a couple of questions that have been posted in the chat box. Are you able to access it, or should I read it out for you?
If you can read the question, that would be fine if it's possible. Otherwise, I will. Can you read the question?
Yeah, sure, sir. So the first question is, how can digitization be used as a strategic lever, considering that technology is becoming a commodity and everyone is using it? Where's the competitive advantage?
Where is the competitive? So there is two questions here, I would say. The first one is, I would take one example from my industry, from the retail industry, to answer that that question. But it's a good question. Very good question. Digitalization first in the retail industry. I would take some example. If you are physically, even physically in the store, I would not speak online, but physically, you can use digitalization, for example, to interact with the customers and to make the interaction much more, I would say, open and interactive. Let me give you an example. If you are digital oriented and you open a store, you can use tablet, for example, and access a 3D screen, make I would share with you one vision. If you want as customer to buy a sanitary ware or a bathroom, let's say, and you don't know really what you need, you are quite uncomfortable with the choices, you hesitate between colors, between the form, etc. When you have this digitalization option in the store, you make the life of the customer much more, I would say, easy. You can show in a 3D screen, the product. You can let the customer have the perspective of the product in his particular house. So that's very powerful. And I will just want to share with you, in my previous company, we use this kind of digitalization. It's the second answer, the second part of the question, where you can use it in retail, for example. We use it physically in the store, and the customer were also able to go to the screen enter some details of the size of the room or the bathroom they have, and with the product they buy, visualize exactly how the kitchen or the bathroom will look like in their specific homes. So it's really a powerful as a tool, and I am convinced that we have to use it. I don't know if I answered the question, if it's okay with you.
Hello, sir. The next question is from Dhananjay. Looking at the situations because of COVID-19, many companies are likely to cut their costs on non-core activities. According to you, how will it impact on the investment in existing as well as incoming digitization projects in industry?
Can you repeat the question a little bit slowly, please, if it's possible? Sorry, the second part, I get it, but the first part, I didn't get you. Sorry for that.
Sure. Looking at the situations, because of COVID-19, many companies are likely to cut their costs on non-core activities. According to you, how will it impact on the investment in existing as well as incoming digitization projects in industry?
Yeah, thank you. I get the question now. So that's the same. It's a very interesting question. Thank you for that. That's a debate now on when you see. I think it was Tata owner Razan Tata who made a short article last week about the investment. For the question, I would say that. The big companies, they will take advantage of this COVID-19 period to even more accelerate, I would say, because they have the possibility to do so and to invest in some technology to make also, that's my meaning, and that was also what Razan Tata was sharing in this article, and I think he was completely right. The company who have the power to to invest even in that COVID-19 period in some new technology, digital technology or future technology, artificial intelligence and robotics, blockchain, etc. They will do because they will also make a difference even more important with their actual competitors. And that's the first part of the answer. And most of the big companies, I think, have understood that as not only a challenge from the perspective of the COVID-19, but also as a real opportunity. It could be very challenging for the small companies or the companies who are. I would say in a disvolting way, growing, I would say, but still with small capitals, that's an issue of capital at the end of the day, of money. And that's also a reality. I mean, if someone tells that, all the small and medium company will, will succeed after the COVID-19. That's probably true for some of them. That's also probably, not true for some of them. And some of them will, unfortunately, will not have the capacity to come back because of the capital issue. So, and that's already a reality. I have some friends, in France and also in India now and in Romania, and, the ones who have started their startup and they have a few, I would say, capital to remain without activity too much time. That's not easy at all. I mean, that's a reality also. So it will depend, but I will suggest still that. The company which are in the middle size, I would say, or small size, on have the capacity to invest reasonably, you know, what we were sharing at the beginning, with some small, you know, tools to help them to accelerate, you know, their, you know, customer, you know, orientation on digitalization. If they still have the capacity to, I will encourage them to do that, because it's, as we have seen in the presentation, it's not, even in that specific period, it's not a matter of if we should, if it's a matter of how we do that. I don't know if I answered the question. I hope I answered the question.
Thank you, sir, for your answer. The next question is, we know the benefits of technology. What are the real world barriers that slow down the adoption process?
Yeah, that's also a very interesting, good question. The real barriers, you know, it was one of the slides in the presentation, but I think, alors, you will say the most, the first answer that come in the mind of lots of people is, okay, it's a matter of investment. That's true for some of the company, of course, because as we said, just we discussed just before, all the company don't have the capital to invest. That's a possible barrier. Donc, that's, I would say, a first answer, a possible answer. The second one, I think, and I really think we should not, you know, underestimate the second barrier, which is, you know, what we discuss together, what we present, I present in the webinar, this mindset, I would say, innovative mindset, which is also a real barrier, and it's not, and I think it's true in all the countries all over the world. You will see, I maybe you see for some of you, that in some company you will have to not, maybe fight is not the good word, but I would say to yes, to you know, to explain, to give a lot of sense why we should you know implant a digital you know organization in my company, whatever is your specific you know activity, why we should you know go to the digital technology, why we should use blockchain. And some people have a mindset, you know, more, I would say, conservative, and would give you a lot of excuses, like, you know, but it works good like this for 20 years. So why do you want to change? And, you know, when you have this kind of mindset, it's quite challenging also. And it could be also a second barrier, you know, to the digital transformation. I hope I answer your question.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. So the next question is from Medha. She says, hello, sir. Thank you for the amazing session. Do you think COVID-19 would lead to disruption of Industry 4.0 in India? And the second question is, would the digitization be accepted in more manufacturing industries in India?
Alors, I will once again, to be sure that I get the question correctly, can you repeat the two questions very slowly, please? Sorry for that.
Sure. Do you think COVID-19 would lead to disruption of Industry 4.0 in India? This is the first question. And the second question is, would the digitization be accepted in more manufacturing industries in India?
Yeah, so it's specific to India. The first one, I would say, I prefer to say that I really don't know. I really don't know to answer the first question, because I don't know. But I think the COVID-19, alors, the COVID-19 is a very important, you know, health issue. I'm not debating that. That's something very important. I don't know, you know, I think it will be in a way, alors, maybe in a strange way, but I think it will help India to move to this 4.2, you know, step, I would say digital step, maybe, like a lot of country. That's my understanding. And that's my understanding from a very, fresh, perspective, because I can't say that I know India in detail. So, but I would say that it will be, from the technological perspective, an accelerator. That's my understanding right now, because, we have to compensate in a way that, the fact that we don't have access physically to a lots of assets, to a lots of tools, with some digital innovation. Donc, in that way, the COVID-19, to be very prudent with the word, but is something with a positive, aspect, I would say. To answer the second question with the digitalization in India, I think, honestly, India is just amazing. I mean, digitalization in India, it's not in the coming 10 years, it's in the coming 20 years, would be, a huge opportunity. And you will be the best ambassador of that digitalization in India. You students from IIT, I think digitalization in India is something, because why I think that digitalization in India would be, something very powerful. And because first, Indian person are, very IT oriented all over the world, in India also. Second, I would not enter in the, I would say, in the political game. But let's say that Indian market is very interesting, even more in the COVID-19 period now, with the, what is happening with the, the China, India becomes more, I would say, attractive. More attractive also for the students, because you have huge opportunities. Maybe more than, I will not challenge that, but maybe more than in the US. So maybe the Indian brands, IT brands, engineer, will remain in India because of that also. So you will have also an acceleration in India because of that, huge opportunity. So from my perspective, yes, digitalization in India will happen. And I think that it will happen in a very powerful way in the coming years. And honestly, this is also for that I am here. Okay, I hope I am right. I don't know if I answered the question. I hope I answered the question.
Sure, sir. Thank you, sir, for the answer. The next question is from Anubhav. He says, hello, Mr. Rubin. Thanks for covering a broad assortment of topics during the session. Your segment on digital transformation was very thought-provoking. It made me wonder that the rate at which technology is evolving may be the technologies that will be essential 10 to 15 years down the line haven't been invented yet. How do you think we should prepare ourselves to adapt and evolve along with the technology? What should be our mindset?
Very good question also. Thank you for that. I think, and I will, once again, I will give you as example, because you are in a very prestigious one more time, a school, IIT. So first you have, I would say, you have all the basis for all the mindset to be successful in the coming years because of your formation. Engineer, most of you are engineer, and even if you are not engineer, you have the background to, to succeed in the digital, world. And I would say the only advice I would say, because he's right, it's not a matter of just 1 year. It's and the question is very powerful. I would say it's for the next 15 or 20 years. I would say that even if you have the technical background, scientist background, digital background, engineer background, you have to follow and to adapt your training. And I will strongly advise, and that's what I am, if you look at, and I'm not a good example necessary, But I had this exigence also with me. I mean, I have made some studies, but I continue to make studies because I really think that, you know, if we compare our generation, or if I compare only my generation with my dad generation or mom generation, parent generation, with my generation, I would say that our generation has to adapt. We have to make, you know, training program. We have to make training program online. We have to make, you know, adaptation, because what we learn today is becoming, you know, unadapted, or, you know, past in, I would say, 1 year, or even quickly in some of the cases. So that's the only advice I would say between the generation. You know, before, my dad, he has done a good school, and after that, that's it. You know, he worked for 40 years and without necessary, I would say, he was curious, of course, but I can't say he has done any really challenging, you know, training program. And I think that we should have a very different mindset now to remain, you know, really, you know, focus on the transformation, on the change in the world, because the world is changing so fast now that we have to adapt ourselves. I don't know if I was clear in my answer. I hope so.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you for the answer. The next question is from Spandan. The question is, what are some challenges to implementation in retail marketing for Dalmia Group?
I will answer not too precisely, because still I want to, you know, preserve some confidential information, but I would say that like a lot of it's a very good question also, because it's true for a lot of actors. I would say I think that what is true for Dalmia is true also for a lot of competitors. One of the big challenge I would say in a lot of startup, because we are a startup in the retail now, is to find, I would say the number one is to find the investors. It's not a matter of technology. It's not an issue of technology. It's not an issue of the willing to do the things. But most of the time, it's an issue of to find the good partnership with the good investors. And that is true also in India, I think. That would be my answer. That would be my answer for that question. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Saurabh. Hello, sir. With the current pandemic situation, the online retail industry has a great challenge in maintaining trust within their customers, ensuring safe deliveries to their doorsteps while maintaining enough profit from sales. What is your take on this business's tackling it?
Yeah, that's true. That's so true. I mean, it's not easy to build the trust between our customers. I would say it's really challenging also with the COVID-19. Why? Because you have to, you know, you have to be very agile one more time. And, you know, you can't say, for example, I will give you an example very concrete. Trust, for example, is even more when you have a corporate communication. Let's say you are a brand quite well-known, let's say. I will not name anyone, but let's say you are a brand A and you are very visible on the market and you have some commitment on the prices, on, you know, on when you have some communication online, on you know, you have to fulfill your commitment. You can't have, you know, you can't, I would say, win the battle of trust if you don't fulfill your commitment. And it's true for you are right, for the safety. It's true for the prices. It's true for the quality of the product that you will sell to your customers. And for that, I think you have to remain digital. It's not the only solution. You have to remain very close to the market, very close to the competitors, and never forget that what is true today maybe is not true tomorrow. So you have to, you know, to make some very, I would say, operational for that in that way. Operational, I would say, benchmark. To be sure that what you are communicating in your site or physically in your store or in your restaurant or whatever is your domain of industry is still true and is not, you know, just, you know, a good words and nothing is true behind the good words. That's not possible. That's not the good way to build a trustful, you know, organization. That will be my answer for that question. But thank you. It was a very good question also.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Omkar. Omkar says, is additive manufacturing one of the technologies that is being currently used or being explored for use in near future at Dalmia Bharat?
Here, I got a part of the question. I lost you when you were speaking about manufacturing. Can you repeat this part, please?
Is additive manufacturing one of the technologies that is being currently used or being explored for use in near future at Dalmia Bharat?
Yeah. So here, you know, I think that the technology that we will use, I will not go too much in detail one more time, but I would say that all the technologies that I present today and I share with you, we are very motivated, I would say, to use that technology. It could be digital, and there is nothing secret about digitalization because, but Dalmia also is a very, you know, digital oriented. And one more time, Punit Dalmia, who is also with the same background, you know, of engineer, is very, digital oriented, does nothing, you know, new, and he communicates also very, you know, often about that. And that's something very visible. I mean, that will be something important for Dalmia in the next years, digital orientation, visibility online, acceleration of the, you know, safety, on trust with your customers, with tools like, of course, you know, artificial intelligence, blockchain, all that, you know, tools that we discuss together today. Of course, they will be part also of Dalmia tools, I would say, in the coming years. I would say they are in this, not in the maturity for all of them, but I would say in the developing mode for some of them already.
Thank you, sir. The last question is from Lohit. He asks, with regard to introduction of digital technologies, what are organizations doing to reskill or upskill?
But can you repeat the last part of the question? I get the first part, the last part I don't get really, really well. Can you repeat the last part, please?
Sure, sir. With regards to introduction of digital technologies, what are organizations doing to reskill or upskill?
Yeah. I think that it's very interesting also. I would say I think that they upskill most of the time, but that's my understanding at least. I would say that first you have to remain never whatever is your challenge with the digital transformation in one way or the other. I think the first important I would say aspect from my perspective at least is, you know, to remain in proximity with the competitors. That was I was sharing a little before, because we discussed that example with, you know, the taxi industry, with Uber. We discuss also a little about Amazon, Big Basket. And, you know, if you don't if you don't have, you know, this perspective of what is doing your competitors, you will not know if you have to upskill or accelerate or not your digital transformation. So that's, I would say that's the first really important, you know, aspect to remain, I would say, and that's something, you know, interesting, connected with the field, with the market. And, you know, I would say the second aspect, when you have the possibility, you know, is to anticipate with, I would say, some specific customers. You know, you have the classical customers which are using the technology, I would say, in a very normal way, but you have also this, you know, fast, you know, learner, customer who are digital oriented or technically oriented. And it's sometimes it's very interesting also to have a focus on that, you know, specific part of customers who can give you, you know, some very interesting information in terms of, technology on what do you have to eventually accelerate, because you have already a trend with that customers, and you can learn from that, I would say, niche of customers to anticipate. That was my meaning, anticipate the future needs of your specific industry. So I would say my answer, two things: to remain connected with the market, with the competitors, with the customers, of course, and to listen to the customers' need. And the second aspect, on for that you have a lot of tools, blogs, online, connection, what we do now also, webinar, table meetings, physical meetings also. The lockdown will, at the time, it will finish. So we will have the possibility also to interact with our customers and to understand what is their need. That's something, by the way, we were doing very well in my previous company. We interact a lot with customers physically to understand what are their needs and also, I would say, their digital needs. And the second aspect is maybe to have a particular focus on the very, you know, high technological customers oriented, which give you a very good sense of anticipation for the needs in the coming years. That would be my answer for that that question.
Thank you, sir, for such an informative session. I think that's the end of the question, sir.
Yeah, what I wanted to tell you, all of you, thank you so much for that session. Honestly, it was a great pleasure for me to interact with you. You are such a very nice student. Please connect with me on LinkedIn. Stay in touch with me. We never know the future, and it will be always a pleasure, you know, to interact with you. And maybe if I had the occasion in the future to come in your very prestigious school and interact physically with all of you and more in detail, I would be very happy for that. But now I would say thank you so much for your time, for your attention, for your question, very smart question, very pertinent question. It was a pleasure for me to prepare that webinar. It was a pleasure to interact with you. Thank you so much.
For taking a snapshot of the session, we like to request the batch, the participants, to switch on their webcams.
Yeah.
Sure, sir. It'll be an honor hosting you sometime on campus, sir. Your insights on the enablers and barriers to digital transformation, the strategy to a successful implementation, the role of technology, and the organizational and leadership mindset required to drive this change has broadened our understanding of the subject. We especially enjoyed the way you illustrated your points with survey data and case studies. It was a great opportunity to learn from your experiences, and we are extremely grateful to you for sparing your invaluable time to interact with us. We look forward to similar engagements in the future and hope that this will be the start of a lasting relationship with you and your organization. Thank you once again, sir, for such a riveting session.
Thank you so much. You are a very nice student. You are a very nice school, and I wish you really the best for the future. And I'm sure you will make a great career in whatever is your activity. And please do not hesitate to connect with me for whatever is your need. I will be very happy to connect with you in the future. Thank you so much.